السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. My name is Ahmed Haroon. I am Internal Medicine and Endocrinology Consultant in مؤسسة القطيف Hospital. And I'm Assistant Professor in Cairo University Internal Medicine Department. Today we will discuss the management of hypertension in diabetic patients. We will have a closer look for the problem of hypertension in a subgroup of patients which are the diabetic patients. As we know all that diabetic patients are very high risk for cardiovascular disease. And of course, hyperglycemia is a core defect in our diabetic patients, but there are many traditional and non-traditional risk factors that predispose these patients for coronary and vascular injury. The most important two factors, traditional factors, are hypertension and dyslipidemia. And they are very common, very, very extremely common in our diabetic patients, and they are very harmful for the vascular tree in these diabetic patients. As we will see, hypertension is very, very common in diabetic patients. The general incidence of hypertension in diabetic patients, in general diabetic patients collectively, type 1 and type 2, is between 20 to 60% in diabetic patients. If we know that the general incidence of hypertension is about 30% in the general population, according to the National Health and Nutrition Examination Survey 2003, that means that our diabetic patient will have almost double the incidence of hypertension than the general population. The prevalence of hypertension in diabetic patients is 1.5 to 3 times, threefolds higher than that of non-diabetic age matching. So hypertension is much, much more common than general population. The problem is that hypertension accelerates and accentuates and causes most of the diabetic complications. As we can see here, that it has been estimated that 35 to 75% of the diabetic complications are augmented or due to hypertension. This is not the problem of hypertension. The problem is that any increase in blood pressure, any increase, will be associated with increased risk of cardiovascular injury. As we can see that an increase in diastolic blood pressure or systolic blood pressure of 5 millimeter, only 5 millimeter mercury, is associated with a concomitant increase of cardiovascular disease by 20 to 30%. And again, this is not the problem, not because hypertension is very common or any increase will augment. The problem is that this increase in risk starts with very low blood pressure readings that we don't consider them in our clinical practice as hypertension. As we can see that the risk of cardiovascular disease doubles with each increase of 20 over 10 systolic and diastolic, starting from what? Starting from 115 systolic and 75 diastolic. This is a problem that in our diabetic patient, in our regular everyday practice, we see many patients with normal blood pressure. We consider them normal blood pressure, but they have almost three or four double the risk of cardiovascular injury because the risk starts to increase once blood pressure increases over 115 over 75 for cardiovascular risk. And also studies for microvascular injury in diabetic patients shown a markedly higher frequency of progression of retinopathy if blood pressure increases more than 70 millimeter diastolic. So we have a very common problem which causes augmentation of all diabetic complication. And we have a group, most of our patients in a group which we don't treat, but they are in a very high risk because of the elevated blood pressure. We can see this in the Mr. Fitz study. We can see these columns for the risk of cardiovascular mortality in diabetic patients, in particular diabetic patients. And we can see that the red column shows the cardiovascular mortality in non-diabetic persons and the green column for the diabetic persons. And we can notice that the risk is two to three, double the normal population. This is not the problem. The problem is that the risk starts to increase once blood pressure starts to increase more than 115 or 120, as we can see. And we can see this also and more in diabetic females, because in diabetic females in particular, they are prone to cardiovascular risk and ischemic heart disease, especially when they are normotensive, especially if they have proteinuria. We can see in this study that normotensive women with type 2 diabetes and microalbuminuria are at increased risk for macrovascular disease despite they are normotensive, which confirms the idea that we have most of our patients in the high risk category without being classified as hypertensive patients. the incidence of hypertension and the nature of hypertension is much different between the group of type 1 diabetics and type 2 diabetics. We can see in type 1 diabetics, the incidence when we discover type 1 diabetes is very low, almost 5%, very, very low. But the risk increases significantly after 20 years to be 33%, and after 40 years, it becomes 70%. The problem in type 1 diabetics is that the disease starts very early, in young age. After 40 years, if the patient is diabetic since he is 10 years, this means that 70% of the type 1 diabetics at the age of 50, 45, or even less, they will be hypertensive. So the incidence is very low once at the start of the disease, but increases with the duration. In type 1, we need duration. And in type 1, it's associated with diabetic nephropathy. We can see here that hypertension affects, in general, collectively, type 1, about 30%, one of every three type 1 diabetic person. And this hypertension needs many years to develop, 20, 30, 40 years. But the problem is that they start their disease at early ages, so they develop it at middle age most of the time. Hypertension usually reflects and is a consequence of diabetic nephropathy. Because these type 1 diabetics, they don't have the complex metabolic background of metabolic syndrome. The situation is very different in type 2 diabetic patients because these patients have a metabolic abnormality. They have very complex genetic and metabolic backgrounds. They have dyslipidemia, they have hypertension, they have increased atherogenicity, increased inflammatory markers, and so on. So once we start the type 2 diabetes, we usually diagnose hypertension in almost half of the patients at the onset of type 2 diabetes. And by established, when the type 2 diabetes is established already, most of the diabetic patients, most of type 2 diabetics, almost 90%, almost 100% are hypertensive at that time. So hypertension is very common, especially in type 2 diabetics. And we can see here that we have to develop diabetic nephropathy, it passes into five stages from hyperfiltration stage that we don't notice up to renal impairment. Once this process starts, the blood pressure starts to increase progressively and gradually, and this is a mechanism for hypertension in type 1 diabetic patients and also for type 2. But for type 2, we have, as we said, a genetic background, and we have insulin resistance, and have many other mechanisms that initiate hypertension in that diabetic patient. So we start with hyperglycemia and genetic background. This hyperglycemia and genetic background usually initiates many metabolic and hemodynamic changes, which will end in development of hypertension. And because they are diabetic and prone to diabetic nephropathy, we have now hypertension and diabetes. So diabetes, hypertension, nephropathy, and nephropathy will increase blood pressure, and this will leave the patient in a vicious circle of elevated blood pressure, nephropathy, elevated blood pressure, and the very, very high risk for cardiovascular disease. We talked about the incidence of hypertension and the nature of hypertension and the differences between type 1 and type 2 regarding hypertension. What about management of hypertension? We will discuss these items in management of hypertension in diabetic patients. Number one, do we have evidence that management of hypertension in diabetic patient is beneficial or not? We will discuss this. And what is the target for blood pressure control in our diabetic patients? Do we have a rule for non-pharmacological management in our, we are talking about diabetic patient, not general population, not management of hypertension in general population. Do we have evidence for non-pharmacological management in our diabetic patient or not? What is the approach for medication and pharmacological management? And there is some specific and special situations in diabetic hypertensive patients. We will discuss them. Regarding evidence for blood pressure control, we have very strong evidence that controlling blood pressure will reduce the cardiovascular and renal complications of diabetes. We can see that while glucose and lipid management remain important, we cannot ignore the importance of statin therapy or management of hyperglycemia. But lowering blood pressure has the greatest, more than lipid and diabetic management, and most immediate impact on morbidity and mortality. If you give your patient a care to control blood pressure over months, you will get benefit over years. Lipids over weeks or months, but for blood pressure, you will get the prize immediately. immediately once blood pressure is controlled within hours, the morbidity and mortality will decrease. So it has a greater and more faster impact on the morbidity and mortality. In a Cochrane review done by Vision and Howard, they reviewed the role of management of hypertension in diabetic patients, and they give conclusion that in type 2 diabetics, aggressive treatment of hypertension reduces the risk of complications, including stroke, MI, and all-cause mortality. And they give another conclusion, which is maybe shocking to some patients, that you have to give priority for blood pressure control and higher priority than blood glucose control based on the UKBDS study. So in this Cochrane review, they give priority for blood pressure control than diabetic management, than blood sugar control in diabetic patients because it has greater impact on morbidity and mortality. We have evidence from many clinical studies like SHIB, CYSTUR, HOT, UKBDS, that management of hypertension will reduce the cardiovascular risk of disease, and the details can be seen on the screen. Cardiovascular mortality was reduced between 25% to 70% in most of the studies once we control blood pressure to at a preset target. We have also many evidence from many clinical studies that once we control blood pressure, we will reduce the incidence or decrease the incidence of new development of microalbuminuria, progression of microalbuminuria to macroalbuminuria, or doubling of the serum creatinine in many studies like IDNT, IRMA2, IRMA3, IRMA2, RENAL, and MARVEL, and so on. So we have strong evidence for the supporting the management of hypertension, role of management of hypertension in diabetic patient in reduction of cardiovascular and renal complications. But we will discuss the biggest five studies dealing with hypertension in diabetic patient in short. The first study is the United Kingdom prospective diabetic study. The number of hypertensive patients, not the total diabetic patient in that study, was 1,148 patients. The follow-up duration initially was 10 years almost and extended to more than that to 20 years. Blood pressure target was 150 over 85 for the controlled group and 180 over 105 for the conventional group. The drugs used was based on captopril versus tenormin. What we have from this study, long study, started with type 2 diabetic patient in early diagnosis, the conclusion that tight control of blood pressure to 150 over 85 is favorable and decreases this from diabetes, decreases stroke, and decreases microvascular complication. We can see that any reduction of systolic blood pressure, 10 millimeter, every reduction of systolic blood pressure, 10 millimeter, will be associated with reduction of the microvascular disease by 13%, myocardial infarction by 11%, diabetic mortality by 15%, and diabetes morbidity by 20%. And the most impact was on retinopathy. We can see that the incidence of reduction and reduced the need for photocoagulation was reduced by 47% once we control blood pressure in that diabetic group to 150 over 85. The second group is the HOT study. This was a big study in almost 19,000 patients. Follow-up duration was almost 4 years. They put the patient into two groups, actually three groups, 80, 85, and 90, but we will talk about 80 to 90, comparing the systolic blood pressure, 80 to 90. And the drugs used was based on calcium channel blocker versus others. And the result is that the less than 80 group had decreased in major reduction in major cardiovascular events. The third study was the HOPE study, and we have 3,500 patients. Follow-up duration was 4.5 years, and the mean blood pressure in this group was targeted to 139 over 79. And the active drug was ramipril versus placebo. We can see the results that ramipril group, targeting blood pressure 139 over 79, had reduction in myocardial infarction, reduction in stroke, reduction in cardiovascular mortality, reduction in nephropathy, and all-cause mortality. In this study, OLHAT study, we have a very large number of patients, 42,000 patients. 13,000 of them were diabetics. And they are, we're followed for 4.9 years, 5 years almost. The targeted blood pressure was 146 over 83. And they compared three medications, chlorthalidone, amlodipine, and lisinopril. The results showed that we have greater reduction of systolic blood pressure with chlorthalidone, and there is no difference for fatal or non-fatal MI, but there was increased incidence of heart failure in the group of amlodipine and lisinopril. What we know from this study is that diuretics are effective in diabetic patients. Amlodipine and lisinopril also were effective without increased risk of fatal or non-fatal MI, with greater reduction and of blood pressure and incidence of heart failure with chlorthalidone. The most important two studies managing hypertension in diabetic patients was the ACCORD study and the ADVANCE study. The ACCORD study was a big study, 5,000 patients almost, for almost 5 years. Systolic blood pressure was targeted for 120, very low systolic blood pressure compared to conventional group of 130 to 140. There is no active medication at that group, at that study. In that study, there was no reduction in the rate of a composite outcome of fatal and non-fatal major cardiovascular events. There was no benefit. If you bring the blood pressure of your patient to 120, he will not get extra benefit in cardiovascular outcomes. But in that study, the only positive was the reduction of stroke, as we will see. They managed to control systolic blood pressure to 118 compared to 137. 119 to 133.5, and at the end of the study, only the positive was a reduction of fatal and non-fatal or total stroke. So we thought from this study that modest blood pressure is better than severe reduction of blood pressure in diabetic patients, which was confirmed in the ADVANCE study. It was conducted in 11,000 patients. Follow-up duration was 4.3 years. Blood pressure target was 145 systolic over 81 diastolic, and the active drug was brindobril indebamide versus matching placebo to control blood pressure to that target. The conclusion of the study is that modest blood pressure, which confirms the result of the ACCORD study, modest blood pressure lowering is beneficial in terms of reduction in risk of critical cardiovascular events and renal endpoints irrespective of baseline blood pressure. We can see here that the reduction of blood pressure was not so big in either systolic or diastolic blood pressure. It was 140 versus 134 in systolic blood pressure, and only 77 versus 74 in diastolic pressure. But this modest, this small amount of reduction of blood pressure was associated with significant reduction of microvascular disease, significant reduction of macrovascular disease, significant reduction of all-cause mortality, and 21% reduction of all renal events, including progression to from micro to macro and to doubling of serum creatinine. So what we thought from these studies, we thought that controlled blood pressure is beneficial for cardiovascular and renal outcomes. Almost all the antihypertensive groups are effective in diabetic patients and can benefit them. And modest blood pressure is better than severe reduction of blood pressure in our diabetic patients, which leads us to the next question. What is the target for blood pressure control in our diabetic patient? We notice from epidemiologic studies and observational studies that the risk of cardiovascular disease increases once the blood pressure increases systolic more than 115 and diastolic more than 75, from observational and from epidemiologic studies. So the initial concept is that once you bring the blood pressure lower, the risk will be low. Once you bring lower, the risk will be low, and so on. So the lower is the better. This is the initial from observational and epidemiologic studies. But in controlled situations and in controlled trials, we found that reduction to less than 140 systolic and 90 diastolic is only associated with benefit. So the concept was changed to, we get blood pressure lower, the risk will be lower and lower and lower till a point. After this point, the curve will be flat. We will have plateau. And even this one was changed because in ENVIS study and on target study, we found that mortality will increase again once we bring the blood pressure lower than certain point. So the mortality may increase again, which brings the J curve famous J curve, and there is many doubt about that J curve. So in ENVIS study, the mortality was good until blood pressure was brought down to 190 systolic and 84 diastolic. The mortality increased again. And on the target study, the best outcome for survival was with blood pressure systolic more than 130. Once we go down 130, the mortality increased again. So the mortality may increase if we bring the blood pressure lower than the specified target. Why? Because we are not dealing with normal vessels. We are not dealing with normal coronaries. We are not dealing with normal renal vessels. The hemodynamics of the vessels in the heart are changing. The diastolic filling for the heart is very important. We cannot go with the diastolic blood pressure below certain limit. According to the American Diabetic Association, the target will be systolic less than 140 and diastolic less than 90. But we can bring systolic and diastolic lower in certain population. For systolic blood pressure, if we have a patient with long life expectancy, young patient, and we want to protect him for a long time, and this patient has other risk factor for stroke, we can go with systolic blood pressure less than 140. The target for all patients, 140 systolic, but in patient with long life expectancy, especially if they have risk for stroke, we can go to 130. The general diastolic target for general diabetic population is 90, but we can go for 80 if we have a patient with long life expectancy and he has some kidney disease or elevated urine albumin creatinine ratio. So the general target 140 systolic, 90 diastolic, but we can go for 130 or 80 in some specific situation. What about the gene C8? They recommend for diabetic hypertensive patient without kidney disease. Diabetic hypertensive patient without kidney disease, a target of less than 140 systolic and 90 diastolic, which is matching with the American Diabetic Association guidelines. The NICE guidelines recommend a lower blood pressure for diastolic. They recommend 140 over 80, but also they can recommend a lower systolic blood pressure if we have kidney disease or eye or cardiovascular disease. So in general, we can conclude that the target should be systolic less than 140 in most of the patients, 90 diastolic for most of the patients, but we can in selected patients, which depends on the evaluation and experience of the physician, to target a little bit lower target to give extra benefit, especially if the patient is young and we has a long life expectancy. Now, what we do for our diabetic patient to manage hypertension? Because hypertension is very important, we have to screen for hypertension every visit. We have to measure blood pressure for our patient every visit, every month. We don't like to wait 3 months, 6 months with high blood pressure. It will affect the outcome. So check blood pressure every routine visit. Patient found to have blood pressure more than 120/80, which is normal. We have to give him advice for non-pharmacological management, low salt intake, regular exercise, stopping smoking, and so on. With 120, more than 120/80, we have to start with him. But if he has blood pressure more than 140/90, we have to give him another day to check again blood pressure to confirm high blood pressure. Patient with blood pressure 120/80 should be advised on lifestyle changes to reduce blood pressure, even 120/80 or more. Patient with 140/90, we have to check again and to confirm that he has hypertension and to take action immediately. We don't like to wait for management of hypertension, and this management should be prompt initiation and timely subsequent titration. We have to start immediately. We don't wait months, and we have to titrate. Don't wait long time, as we'll see. In most of our diabetic patients, we need more than one medicine. Start, follow up, titrate immediately. Don't wait for long time. Pharmacological therapy for diabetic hypertensive patients should include either an ACE or ARB if we are giving more than one medicine. If one class is not tolerated, we can shift to the other without preference for either ACE or ARB. Multiple drugs, more than two drugs, usually is taken in diabetic patient and generally required to achieve blood pressure target. If blood pressure is refractory, we can add third agent, but we will see that if we give more than three medications, including diuretic, and the blood pressure is not controlled, we have to think about secondary hypertension, and we will see this in special situations. If S inhibitors or ARBs are being to be used, we have to be careful and follow creatinine, sodium, potassium, and so on after starting the medication and subsequently. For lifestyle therapy, we don't have studies in diabetic patients testing the lifestyle modification for hypertension, but we can apply the guidelines from general hypertensive patients, not diabetic, to the diabetic population. So we have to reduce the salt intake to 2 gram, 0.300 milligram per day. The goal may be lower in specific patients, not controlled on multiple medications, very high risk patients. But the general target for diabetics to give 2.3 gram sodium per day. We have to reduce weight as much as we can. And we have to increase fruits, vegetables to 8 to 10 servings per day, and to decrease low-fat dairy products, increase low-fat dairy products 2 to 3 servings per day. We have to increase physical activity, even if this physical activity is not will not be associated with weight loss. It will benefit the metabolic background of the patient, and it will improve cardiovascular and pulmonary markers, even if the blood pressure, if the weight is not reduced. So if your diabetic patient is doing regular exercise and he's not losing weight, please tell him, continue regular exercise. You have benefit. Only the weight is not benefited, but many other benefits is gained from this regular exercise. The patient should be advised and should be advised and should be advised every visit to stop smoking and, of course, to avoid alcohol. According to the guidelines of American Diabetic Association, avoid excessive alcohol consumption, no more than 2 servings per day in men and no more than 1 serving for females. This is for non-pharmacological management. What's about the pharmacological management? We only look for the figure of blood pressure. We don't look for the medicine. So the patient will benefit once we bring his blood pressure to normal, to target, whatever the medication used. So in randomized clinical trials, and we saw this in OLHAT and many other studies, diuretics, ACE inhibitors, beta blockers, ARBs, and calcium channel blockers all have treatment, all have benefit in treating hypertensive in diabetic patients. The target is to bring the blood pressure to the targeted blood pressure, whatever the medication. But the RAS inhibitors, ACE and ARBs, have in diabetic in, population especially, they have advantage because they may reduce the cardiovascular risk or renal risk. So in diabetics, RAS system inhibitors may have unique advantage, unique for initiation or early treatment. We can think of them earlier than the other groups. Evidence for distinct advantage is still controversial, but because we have very high risk for cardiovascular disease, we think about these medications first. To conclude this, we have a very nice approach for management of hypertension in diabetic patients. This is the most important slide. Once we have diabetic patient, my diabetic patient, and his blood pressure is elevated, so we have a diabetic patient with hypertension now. We can start with any medication if the patient doesn't have albuminuria. So we have diabetes, developed hypertension, but no albuminuria. You can start ACE, ARB, thiazide, whatever, but we can think earlier for ACE and ARB. If the patient has microalbuminuria, now we have diabetic patient, his blood pressure is above 140/90, and he has microalbuminuria. In that situation, we prefer ACE or ARB to start with. But of course, the other medication can help this patient, but in this situation, we have clear advantage for ACE and ARBs. If we have a patient with hypertension, diabetes, and his blood pressure is elevated now, and he has macroalbuminuria, the new term for macroalbuminuria, severely increased albuminuria, we have to give ACE or ARB. So macroalbuminuria, it's not preferred. You have to give ACE or ARB. And of course, if you have any patient, diabetic and hypertensive, and he's taking more than one medication, this treatment milieu should include ACE or ARB. This is the approach adopted from up to date. Of course, we can use diuretics, but once the glomerular filtration rate reduced less than 30, we stop thiazide diuretics and shift to Lasix, because thiazide diuretics will not work in such a population. We have 5 special situations in diabetic hypertensive patients. We have a diabetic patient, hypertension, but we have, for these patients, they have specific features. Number one, these patients are very difficult to control than the general hypertensive patient without diabetes. So we can see that in most of the clinical trials, to control blood pressure to target, usually we use 2, 3, or even 4 medications. The message here is that start immediately with a medicine, whatever you choose. Once we don't have macroalbuminuria or microalbuminuria, any medicine can work, but we prefer ACE or ARB. Prefer. And don't wait. If blood pressure is not controlled, usually the diabetic patient will need one more than one. Don't wait. Your action should be rapid and immediate to control blood pressure because they are not usually controlled on one medication. The second specific situation is that we know that blood pressure goes down, as we can see from the graph, the night hours, the blood pressure goes down, which gives rest to the heart and the vessels. This is called dipping of the blood pressure. And there is many hypertensive patients are non-dippers. They don't have this dipping of blood pressure. And this predisposes them to extra risk for cardiovascular disease. The diabetic population, in general, are more non-dippers than the general hypertensive patient. So if in our diabetic patient, hypertensive patient, we expect that they don't have this good dipping during the night. They are generally non-dippers. So if you are giving a medication for your diabetic patient, it's better to ensure that blood pressure is controlled at night. If you're giving 2 medications, better to give 1 in the morning or and 1 in the evening. If you are giving 3 medications, you can give 1 or 2 evening and 1 in the morning and so on. So don't forget this. If you are giving more than 1 medicine, better to give 1 or 2 at night. And this was proved in many clinical trials to reduce the cardiovascular risk. The third feature in diabetic patients that we usually overlook and forget that this patient, diabetic hypertensive patient, may have secondary hypertension. Of course, type 2 diabetics usually have hypertension associated with diabetes, but sometimes they have secondary hypertension. If your diabetic hypertensive patient is taking 3 medications, and this is include diuretic, and he's not controlled, please think again that he may have secondary hypertension. And we can see from this study, primary aldosteronism can be found and is common in diabetic patients. We have to think about primary aldosteronism, and there is another very common cause for secondary hypertension in diabetic hypertensive patient, which is renal vessel atheroma, because we have general atherosclerosis, which may affect both one or both of renal arteries. We have to think about that. So if blood pressure is not controlled in 3 medications, including diuretic, you have to think about secondary hypertension. You have to check kidney functions, kidney sizes. You have to check renin aldosterone ratio. If both renin and aldosterone ratio are high, we have to think about atherogenic renal disease. If aldosterone is high, renin is low, we have to think about primary hyperaldosteronism. Don't forget your patient if taking more than 3 medication and is not controlled. Think about secondary hypertension. The other feature is that in our diabetic patient, we may have some diabetic patient with nephropathy, but their blood pressure is not high. Should we give them treatment or not? Should we give him ACE or ARB or not? We have diabetic patient, and he has microalbuminuria or macroalbuminuria, but his blood pressure is 120/80, 120/70. We can see this in our clinical practice. Should we give them medication or not? This area is controversial, but we are sure that we don't give prophylactic antihypertensive for diabetic patient without proteinuria and without hypertension. There is no prophylaxis. If he has diabetes without elevated blood pressure, without albuminuria, no rule. But there is controversy to give or not for diabetic patient with nephropathy, with macroalbuminuria or macroalbuminuria, and blood pressure is normal. For myself, usually, I follow the patient carefully. If he is progressing, from micro to macro, and usually I give him ACE or ARB to try to stop this deterioration. Even the blood pressure is, but we have to be careful not to lower blood pressure too much because it may have bad consequences for the patient. The last specific situation that we have diabetic patient, and this diabetic patient is a female, hypertensive, diabetic, female, hypertensive, and she get pregnant. This is a specific situation. Why? Because many of our antihypertensive medication, actually antihypertensive medication, antidyslipidemic medication, and many other medication are contraindicated. Even some diabetic medication cannot be given in pregnancy, most of the diabetic medication. So if we have a young female, diabetic hypertensive and she is not using contraception, we have to plan our medication, either diabetes or hypertension, that she may have pregnancy at any time. We have to choose a suitable medication for her. And the target, as we can see, in diabetic hypertensive pregnant ladies is much lower than our target. This is a specific situation, 110 to 130 systolic, 65 to 80 diastolic. We have to choose the drug from beta blockers, abetalol is one of the best, Aldomet, of course, prazosin, diltiazem, and clonidine. ACE and ARBs are completely contraindicated in pregnancy, and if your patient is young, female, diabetic, hypertensive, and she's not using contraception, please don't use ACE or ARB. Don't use statin, because this may have severe bad consequences on the pregnancy outcome. To conclude what we said, we can say that the presence of hypertension in diabetic patient has a strong, is much more common than general population, and it has a strong link to the diabetic complication, especially cardiovascular disease, stroke, progression of renal disease, and retinopathy. Also, while glucose and the blood pressure management and the blood lipid management is very important, but blood pressure control has immediate and a greater impact on the overall outcome of our diabetic hypertensive patient with multiple comorbidities. Randomized clinical trials, as we discussed in details, have demonstrated that the benefit will come once we get blood pressure to target, whatever the medication. But as we said, we prefer either diuretic, ACE/ARB, beta blocker, calcium channel blocker, they will get benefit for all our patients. But we prefer sometimes ACE or ARB, especially if we have very high risk for cardiovascular disease, and especially if we have microalbuminuria, and in particular if we have macroalbuminuria. Administer one or more of your antihypertensive medication at night, because most of the diabetic hypertensive patients are non-dibbers, and they have extra risk, extra. To many risks, they have extra risk for this non-dibbing to increase cardiovascular risk. Move one of your medication tonight or more one medication tonight, and at last, pregnancy is a specific situation in a specific situation. In ladies, young, diabetic, hypertensive, and they got pregnancy, they have to be dealt in a different way with different target and different medication. Thank you very much for your listening and attendance.